Hello, my name is Eiko Pras. Today we will discuss the SNMP architecture. First, we will shortly explain the design decisions. After that, we discuss the SNMP architecture and give examples of managers and agents and explain some concepts and terminology. The third topic is the SNMP message structure. Note that the various SNMP PDUs that are carried within these messages are explained in another video. We will conclude with SNMP security and access control. The design decisions behind SNMP are explained in RFC 3411, which defines the architecture for the SNMP management framework. That RFC was defined in 2002. Remember that the problem with the first versions of SNMP was the lack of security. The community string acted as a kind of password that was exchanged over the wire in plain text. Whereas that might be acceptable for reading MIP objects, that is certainly unacceptable for setting MIP objects. SNMP version 3 therefore needed to address the need for secure set support. Note that MIP modules do not need to include settable objects. The second requirement is that the architecture should allow for longevity of SNMP. That indeed succeeded, since SNMP is still being used and the RFC that describes the architecture is still valid, although there have been some updates. The third requirement is that the architecture should define separate modules, allowing that these modules proceed at different speeds towards standard status. Remember that there have been competing proposals before this architecture got defined, and thus the requirement to separate into different modules allow a divide and conquer approach. The fourth requirement is that future extensions should be possible. And indeed, at later stages, new security models were defined once better crypto protocols appeared. The requirement to keep SNMP as simple as possible remained, as well as the support for minimal implementations in cases where advanced functionality is not needed, but support also for big and complex networks should be there, if necessary. Finally, existing specifications should be reused whenever possible. Remember from our earlier video on the history of SNMP that competing factions within the IETF came up with different proposals. The idea was to reuse these proposals whenever possible. Here we see the basic architecture, which was developed for SNMP version 3, although also SNMP version 1 and version 2c satisfy this architecture. We see that an SNMP entity consists of applications as well as an SNMP engine. The SNMP engine includes multiple modules, of which the dispatcher, message processing subsystem, and security system must always be there. On the next slides, we will show how this architecture can be used for managers as well as for agent systems. Here we see the architecture of an SNMP manager. The application subsystem consists of two modules, the command generator, which issues GET and SET requests, and the notification receiver that handles the reception of informs and traps. The SNMP engine, thus the blue part below, shows the dispatcher, message processing, and security subsystems. The dispatcher receives commands from the application, handles these commands to the message processing subsystem for further processing, and sends the final message over the transport layer using transport mappings. The message processing subsystem selects whether to use SNMP version 1, version 2c, or version 3 encoding. In case of version 1 and version 2c, it uses the community-based security model, and for version 3, the user-based security model is used. The agent looks quite similar, except that the application includes a command responder and notification originator. Of course, the SNMP application also contains the management information base. To allow different managers to access different parts of the MIP, the access control subsystem is used to limit access. Two concepts are really important to understand SNMP: the notion of an SNMP engine ID and that of a context. Let's first explain the term SNMP Engine ID. As we can see, every SNMP entity has one SNMP engine identified by its SNMP Engine ID. However, a single system may include multiple SNMP entities. Within a managed domain, the SNMP Engine ID must be unique. The question can now be asked how to assign an SNMP Engine ID. Before answering that question, we have to know that the syntax is defined by a textual convention as part of the SNMP framework MIB. Thus, there is not a SMI basic type for the SNMP Engine ID. The textual convention says that the SNMP Engine ID must be an octet string with a size between 5 and 32 octets. The value of the SNMP Engine ID can be determined by a human operator or by an automatic algorithm. In the last case, the algorithm uses the private enterprise number. For the University of Twente, this number is for example 785, and an IP version 4, version 6 or a MAC address. The term Engine ID is frequently used in the SNMP standards, but in slightly different forms. If you are not aware, you may easily mix up these terms and get confused. This table, therefore, shows which variants can be found. The first row shows the SNMP Engine ID, as we have just discussed. If the term starts with a capital letter S, we mean the textual convention that defines the syntax of this identifier. If we read the RFCs that define the SNMP architecture, we also find the terms Security Engine ID as well as Context Engine ID. In the third and fourth row, the terms found in the architectural document are colored green. However, the terms Context Engine ID and Message Authoritative Engine ID are used for the parameters that can be found in SNMP messages. So if you analyze such messages using tools such as Wireshark, you will see the Context Engine ID and the Message Authoritative Engine ID. Later in this tutorial, we will explain how these two terms are used within SNMP messages. Finally, we may find in various MIB modules objects that include the term Engine ID. Therefore, think twice when you see a term including Engine ID and don't get confused. On the previous slide, we introduced the term context engine ID. But what is a context? To understand that, imagine a system including two Ethernet cards to support two Ethernet interfaces. For each card, a dedicated Ethernet MIB module needs to be instantiated. But how can a manager distinguish between these two cards? In the past, several tricks were used, such as using different community strings to access different cards. With the definition of the SNMP architecture, contexts were introduced to make such distinction. So the first card can be named card 1 and the second card 2. A context name is now included in each SNMP message to identify if the manager is interested in the first or in the second card. Next to the context name parameter, SNMP messages also include a context engine ID parameter. The context engine ID carries the value of the SNMP engine ID. The modules that we have discussed on the previous slides are defined by the IETF in a number of RFCs. Note that there is not a single RFC that describes the complete SNMP architecture, since the design requirements that we discussed before said that, amongst others, different modules should move independently towards the status of full standard. The dispatcher and message processing module is standardized by RFC 3412 and describes the SNMP version 3 message structure and the message processing and dispatcher MIB, which contains some counters for processing errors. The SNMP version 3 message structure will be discussed on the next slide. The SNMP applications are standardized in RFC 3413, which also includes a number of MIP modules describing, for example, how to deal with notifications. Remember that notifications allow agents to signal events to the manager by using inform or trap PDUs. The security subsystem is standardized in RFC 3414 and defines the user-based security model that is used for SNMP version 3. Finally, RFC 3415 standardizes the view-based access control module used by SNMP version 3. In the remainder of this tutorial, we will first discuss the SNMP version 3 message structure, followed by the security model and the access control subsystem. This picture shows the SNMP version 3 message structure. Before we explain this picture, remember that SNMP distinguishes between messages and PDUs. The message is what is being transferred over the wire and can be inspected by tools such as Wireshark. The PDU is contained within the message and may be a GET, SET, INFORM or TRAP. Remember that with SNMP versions 1 and 2 there were only two message fields, one for holding the message version and another for the community string. The SNMP version 3 message starts also with a field for the message version, and this field is used by the message processing subsystem. The next four fields, message ID, maximum message size, flags, and the security model for this message, are used by the SNMP v3 processing module. Then the message contains the security parameters, which are used by the security subsystem. These parameters are used for encryption and authentication. Note that authentication is performed over all fields of the SNMP message to ensure that no field can be modified by any man in the middle. The last part, the context engine ID, context name and PDUs, are used by the access control subsystem and the various SNMP applications. This last part is also called the scoped PDU, and only this part of the message will be encrypted. Note that, as opposed to authentication, it is not possible to encrypt also earlier fields of the SNMP message, since these fields are needed by the receiving SNMP entity to perform decryption. On the next slide, we will first discuss these fields in more detail and explain how encryption and authentication works. Let's now discuss the parameters used by the SNMP version 3 processing module. The message ID serves the same purpose as the request ID in SNMP version 1 and 2. It is used to associate responses to requests, since a manager may send multiple requests in a row. SNMP is running over UDP, thus there is no guarantee that responses will be received in the same order as the requests. The maximum message size is a new field introduced by SNMP version 3 to allow managers to better predict the number of objects that can be carried within a single message. We see that the minimum value is 484 bytes, which is a legacy from the times that SNMP should be able to run also over IPX. IPX is a pre-internet protocol defined in the 1970s by Xerox Network Systems. Although some people have proposed to raise this minimum value, it turned out that changing something that has been standardized in the past is virtually impossible. In practice, the value that most systems support will be the maximum length of an Ethernet packet, thus around 1500 bytes. However, if IP fragmentation is used, implementations may also support 64 kilobyte. The message flags indicate if the message is authenticated and/or encrypted. The reportable flag indicates if the sender is prepared to receive report PDUs, which can be used internally by SNMP version 3 for administrative purposes. Finally, the message security model indicates if the user security model is defined in RFC 3414 is used or some other security model. Before we continue, it is good to highlight that there are two aspects of security. secure access to the data within the MIB and secure transport of the data over the wire. The first aspect, secure access to MIB data, is the subject of access control, is defined by the view-based access module. At this level, we find access control lists. The second aspect, secure communication, is defined by the user security model and takes care of encryption and authentication. The SNMP version 3 RFCs identify 6 threats, of which 4 are being handled and 2 not. There is protection against replay attacks, and timestamps are being used to provide such protection. Masquerade attacks, thus attacks in which an attacker pretends to be a legitimate manager, are protected via the use of authentication mechanisms, such as MD5 and AMAC SHA. If such mechanisms are used, changes in the message via a man-in-the-middle attack will be detected as well, so integrity protection is provided as well. The threat that messages get disclosed to others is addressed via encryption algorithms. The algorithms that was initially specified was DES, but later better encryption algorithms appeared, such as Triple DES and AES. No protection is provided against denial of service and traffic analysis attacks. Denial of service attacks are attacks on the manager or agent to make them unresponsive. In practice, such attacks hardly take place. However, SNMP agents are sometimes misused in amplification attacks against other systems. But these are threats against other, often non-SNMP systems. Such attacks should be prevented by configuring the agent system and firewalls in the right way. Traffic analysis attacks may be used to discover the topology of the network. This allows attackers to determine which systems act as manager and agents, and how management is being performed. Such attacks should generally be performed from within the managed network. Protection against such attacks may require the exchange of fake messages to fool the attacker. Let's now focus on the parameters that are used by the user security model. The first three parameters, message authoritative engine ID, message authoritative engine boots, and message authoritative engine time, are used to detect replay attacks. The message username is used to protect against the other threats, masquerade, integrity, and disclosure. For masquerade and integrity, also the message authentication parameter field is needed, which basically includes the 12 octets message authentication code. For disclosure, also the message privacy parameters field is needed, which contains the key needed for decryption. On the next slides, we discuss the use of these parameters in some more detail. Let's start to explain how replay protection is performed. In general, replay protection could be based on timestamps expressed in UTC time. Unfortunately, such approach would require that all devices know the precise time and therefore implement the network time protocol or get synchronized with, for example, GPS. Remember, however, that one of the design goals behind SNMP was that, whatever happens, SNMP should remain operational. Therefore, the decision was taken to not rely on the network time protocol or GPS. Instead, each agent maintains a local clock, and the master keeps track of that agent's clock. Since the agent's clock may restart from zero after a reboot, also the number of times the agent was rebooted needs to be maintained. Therefore, the agent must have some permanent memory to store the number of reboots. An obvious question is now how the manager knows the value of the agent's clock. The RFCs describe a complete mechanism for that, but conceptually, the manager just asks the agent whenever needed. Note that there's nothing secret about knowing the current time and the number of boots of the agent, so that information can be shared freely. Since the clock on the manager and agents may slowly get out of sync, there is a small interval of multiple seconds that is defined by the allowed lifetime. Within that interval, the message will still be accepted. If a message is not accepted, the manager will be informed of this and conclude that his local notion of the agent's time didn't match. The manager may now ask the agent for its time and try again. In the picture, the fields ID, boots and time are in fact the fields message authoritative engine ID, message authoritative boots and message authoritative time of the previous slide. The principle behind authentication and integrity is that a hash function is fed with the data that should be protected, plus a key that is known by both the manager as well as the agent. The hash function performs some calculations and delivers a message authentication code called MAC, which acts as an electronic signature. This signature is 12 octets long and cannot be calculated unless the data and key are known. The hash function is performed over the entire SNMP message, and the MAC is inserted into the message authentication parameters field of that message before it is sent to the other side. Once the message is received by the other side, the MAC is extracted from the message authentication parameters field and the remaining message is entered as data into the hash function. In addition, also the authentication key is entered into the hash function. If the resulting MAC is the same as the MAC extracted from the received message, we know for sure that the key is the same as used by the sender and that the data has not been modified by an attacker in the middle. Since the MAC is also calculated over the replay protection fields, we are certain that the message has not been replayed. Since the agent may be queried by different managers, a user identifier is also included in the message to allow the agent to determine which key belongs to that manager. In the picture, the fields user and MAC are in fact the fields message username and message authentication parameters that we have seen in the USM message structure. The principle behind confidentiality is that an encryption algorithm is fed with the data that should be encrypted, plus an encryption key that is known by both the manager as well as the agent. Note that this form of encryption is called symmetric encryption. There exists also another form of encryption, called public key encryption, in which the sender and receiver use different keys. Although public key encryption is much safer, it requires also much more compute power. Therefore, SNMP relies on symmetric key encryption. The original specification required the use of a DES encryption algorithm in CBC mode. This is relatively unsafe and nowadays the AES algorithm is used in cipher feedback mode. Here we see the sender and receiver of the encrypted message. Once the message is received, the encrypted data is taken out and used as input to the encryption algorithm. The key that belongs to the sender is retrieved based on the user field and the result is the unencrypted data. Note that encryption is performed over the scoped PDU and not the entire message, as was the case with authentication. The user is again encoded in the message username parameter field. Near the end of this tutorial, we will shortly present the ideas behind the view-based access control model. In fact, we need to understand two concepts: the access control table and MIP views. The access control table looks as follows. In the first column, we specify the various MIP views. The second column specifies which operations are allowed for each specific MIP view. The third column specifies which managers may perform these operations. Finally, the last column specifies which security level is required. For example, the first row shows that Manager John is allowed to perform set operations on the interface table, provided operations are encrypted and authenticated. The third row specifies that Manager George may perform GET and GETNEXT operations on the systems group without any form of encryption and authentication. Finally, MIP views define specific parts of the MIP tree. Note that access control tables and MIP views must be pre-configured by the manager within the agent. These are not parameters within SNMP messages. This brings us to the end of our tutorial on the architecture of SNMP, as standardized for version 3. We have tried to explain the main design decisions as well as some basic concepts and ideas. SNMP version 3 introduces the possibility to perform secure set and get operations. In practice, encryption and authentication is hardly used, however. One of the reasons for that is the complexity to make SNMP secure. Still, SNMP is heavily used for unencrypted retrieval of management data. The fact that security is hardly used is not a severe risk, since most managers have closed the ports used by SNMP to the outside world. These ports are UDP ports 161 and 162. What is probably the most important lesson of this tutorial is that protocols that become successful may never disappear. Protocol decisions that are made decades ago may still have impact on current networks.